Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for being here, joining us on this special panel that we are presenting with Miami-Dade College and Forward.us on immigration reform. We have an outstanding standing panel that's going to be with us today. But before I briefly present the panel, I would like to recognize Dr. Eduardo Padron, who's president of Miami-Dade College, who has made this forum possible for us. Dr. Padron.
Yeah.
Where would Miami be without Dr. P? Thank you so very much. And now we have an outstanding panel, and they don't need any introduction, but just in case, very briefly, we have Jorge Plasencia, who is a media entrepreneur and has been involved in radio and television. What hasn't he been involved with? Currently, his current passion is being a president and founder of República, which is an advertising and public relations firm, go-to company for everything that connects to the Hispanic community. And he's also chairman of National Council of La Raza. Jorge. Thanks for being
thank
here.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you,
Helen. Then we have Dan Garza. Dan Garza, we were joking that we've only physically been together maybe three times, but we speak at least 177 times. And that's because Dan is a founder of the LIBRE initiative, which is an extraordinary national organization, grassroots Hispanic organization that espouses conservative principles of liberty, freedom, and small government. Dan, thanks for being here. The guy next to him, we really don't know. I keep forgetting who the guy next to Dan Garza is, but I'm told he is Congressman Mario Diaz-Balart. Mario and I know, and you know, in Miami, we're very casual. We say Mario, Ileana, and Congressman Diaz-Balart is an outstanding spokesperson for immigration reform. He's been working on this issue most of his adult life, but very much in particular from 2006 on. We have our fingers crossed and very hopeful that this is the year. He was and still is part of a very unique group of people who are working in Congress right now on immigration reform. Congressman, thanks for being with us today. Every great party needs a great woman, and Ileana Ros-Lehtinen is the great woman in the Republican Party, another woman who has served on various capacities, has chaired the Committee of Western Hemispheric Affairs, International Relations for Congress, and is currently chair of the Committee for Sub-Sahara Affairs, Middle East Affairs for Congress, and needless to say, an outstanding supporter of immigration reform. Congresswoman.
Thank you.
And of course, if we're going to talk about somebody who is from a very, very small group of the most influential people who has truly changed the way we look at communications and actually communicate today, there's a whole generation that's taking over today that doesn't know communications any other way. And it's thanks to visionaries and pioneers and geniuses like Joe Green. Joe, thanks for being here. Joe doesn't have a Miami accent, but this microphone might do that for you, so you never know.
The microphone will roll my R's
for
me.
Yeah, there you go, there you go. Just another cafecito will do it. Let's start this conversation, and let me start with you, Jorge Plasencia. Brief remarks as to why immigration reform is significant, and there's something that I do want to highlight about the work that you do with the National Council of La Raza. NCLR is considered to be, you know, an organization that is very pro-Democrat party. Janet Murguia, who is one of the foundations of NCLR, was a legislative advisor for President Bill Clinton. Everybody knows you are a staunch Republican. And I think what this shows us is that NCLR has really changed. It's becoming more, it's becoming nonpartisan. And Janet Murguia herself challenged President Obama, calling him deporter-in-chief. Jorge.
Thank you, Helen, and thank you all for having me this morning, and it's great to be here. Yeah, I mean, I've been on the NCLR board now for, just to give you a little bit of history, I've been on the NCLR board now 8 years. And I remember when Janet Murguia reached out to me, and at the time, Monica Lozano was the chairman of the board. Janet reached out. She said, "You know what, Jorge? You know, you're from Miami. You're Cuban American. You're in marketing and communications. You know, these are things that we need on the board. You know, when you look at board governance." And she goes, "And you're a perceived Republican." You know, she goes, "And I, you know, I want to diversify our board more and more." And to her credit, she has done that. You know, in the time that she has been there, I mean, obviously the organization's always been, it's a 501c3, always been nonpartisan, but I would say that in the last years, you know, I think NCLR knows that to get, and Janet knows, having worked at the White House in Legis Affairs, that to get anything done, you need both sides. You need to be working with both sides of the aisle, and you need to bring both sides of the aisle together to get legislation done. And she knows that, having worked hand in hand with these offices, you know, with the Diaz-Balarts, with Ileana's office when she was at the White House, you know, she knows that. She knows.
Okay, so as a Republican, you have definitely seen that there is extraordinary Republican support today for immigration reform. It's been a real game changer as opposed to 2006.
All the polls, as we know, and you know, we keep up with all the polls. Over 86% of Republicans, of Democrats, are for immigration reform. I mean, it's extraordinary. And if there's one issue that I think we can all come together on, and we have for the most part, is immigration reform. I mean, at NCLR, we've been working hand in hand with Mario's office, with Ileana, with Luis Gutierrez, with so many folks on both sides. Yet, you know, our strategy as we're looking at the weeks ahead, you know, is we're gonna stay strong on this three-pronged approach that we have at NCLR. One is obviously focused on being very focused on House Republicans, working with our friends in the House, on making sure they understand how important it is to get this done. I feel, and as you said, I am a Republican. Sometimes I feel I'm a moderate Republican in how I look at issues. But, you know, as a Republican, I think that this will have a lasting impact on our party if this doesn't get done. And I think people aren't seeing that. People aren't noticing that, and they're not, and if they are, como diríamos en español, se están haciendo la vista gorda. You know, they're like, you know, they're, and that's unfortunate. You know, that there's this nearsightedness and not the vision for how this could affect the party. So that's number one. Number two, obviously, like you said, is staying focused on the White House and you know, working with the folks there on having them understand how important this is and that we don't agree with the deportations. And, you know, when Janet said those words, I think it spoke to the importance of somebody like Janet saying those words, you know, and speaking how, you know, frustrated our community is with the deportations. You know, and the good news is we've seen in the last weeks, we've seen some changes, you know, starting to take place in that effect. And then the third prong of our strategy is very focused on our community. You know, very focused on our community, raising their voices, calling their members' office, you know, going out and doing candlelight visuals, you know, working with the Dreamers in their local communities, with the faith-based organizations. I was with Reverend Luis Cortez a few weeks ago in Washington. As you know, he's from Philadelphia, major faith-based leader. So working with all these different groups on coming together as one, no matter if we're Republican, Democrat, Independent, Cuban, Mexican, Peruvian, Bolivian, Jewish, Catholic, coming together, evangelical, coming together as one community and saying, this has to happen. And I have to commend, you know, the gentleman that I have right here, Mario Diaz-Balart. I mean, he has been a fearless leader, and I have seen it firsthand. He and his staff. Yep. He and his staff have been fearless leaders on this. And I have to say, they've worked hand-in-hand with Clarissa Martinez de Castro, our staff at NCLR, and Janet and others.
She's excellent.
She's excellent. Working hand-in-hand on making sure we're out there and we're fighting the fight, and those doors, we're knocking them down. You know, we're getting into those offices and we're speaking, and we're raising our voices. So I have to say that, and obviously Luis Gutierrez, who's been working hand-in-hand with him. It's so great to have
Luis
these two.
Luis Gutierrez, who's congressman from Chicago, Democrat.
Yeah.
Just a strong ally in this, and it really goes to show that bipartisanship does exist, It can be accomplished. It's not always easy.
It's not always
but
easy.
But it can happen.
Thank
Dan
you.
Garza, let me ask you. You have a fascinating personal history. Your parents were migrants, worked in the fields out west. You did too as a child. This resonates on a very personal level to you.
Well, you know, my parents saw America like other migrants did, immigrants who came to America, as the shining city on the hill, as the promised land. They came to America because they wanted to improve their condition, because their country of origin, their economic system wouldn't allow for that. And they saw in America that they could be free to prosper. And it wasn't only them. It was also my aunts and my uncles. It was a lot of us who came over to America. I was born in California during the crop season. And I was a migrant farm worker as well up until the time I was 18. So I lived the migrant experience. I saw that the Border Patrol come into the orchards and make sweeps and take people away who were friends, who were, you know, work colleagues both in the fields and the orchards. And it was something else to see in real life, in real time, how families were torn apart. Families who were industrious, who were hardworking, who came to America to also improve their condition. The immigrant experience is a common experience, and mine was a common experience. I'm nothing unique. I guess what it is unique about me is that here I was, a son of migrant farm workers who had the privilege to work for George W. Bush at the White House. And it's a reflection of America. It really is a reflection of America. How Senator Ted Cruz put it once, I think nobody else has put it better. It is a country where somebody with nothing can achieve anything, regardless of color, race, creed, or whatever. We have a system of opportunity. And so, and I've been going across America talking about immigration for
a moment. And if I can just interject for a moment, and one of our graduations here at Miami-Dade College, and I say our, not because I'm confused, I chair the board of trustees of Miami-Dade sure. College, and I say that proudly. In one of our graduations, we had Vice President Joe Biden, and we were giving an honorary degree to the president of Georgia Mason University, who comes from Spain. And he said, only in America can two presidents of two distinguished colleges, Dr. Eduardo Padron from Miami-Dade College and the president of George Mason, be in a podium with the Vice President of the United States. And it just says a lot about the greatness of this country. And that's
it's exceptional. It really is a special place. It's a special place because of our democracy and our economic system. It's a system that rewards hard work. And it has to continue to be that system, because that's not a system that many countries in Latin America had. And they said, well, you know, if immigrants drive prosperity, if immigrants, you know, bring so much wealth and generate more wealth when they come here, why don't they do it in their countries of origin? Because they don't have the economic system we have here. And so at the LIBRE Initiative, that's what we fight for. Actually, we don't fear waves of poor immigrants coming into America. We fear a government that would stifle opportunity for those poor immigrants. In order for us to be able to absorb them and they create new wealth. That's what America was built on, waves of poor immigrants. That is our history. And so we join others to call for reform. The status quo is not acceptable. The system that we have now does not allow us to absorb folks, to meet market demand, to legalize the relationship between employer and employee, to legalize a very rational activity of folks wanting to sell their labor to improve their condition. So we're involved in that business, and we want to get on also with the business of getting our kids educated, regardless of what their parents did or didn't do. So we want to be helpful in that, and we've spent over $1 million in an ad campaign to drive immigration reform. For us, our preference would be a path to citizenship, but if we can get legality, let's get that. And so I also want to join the praise of Congressman Mario Diaz-Balart. The work he has done is commendable, is absolutely impressive. In the face of so much opposition at times when he first started out to where he's gotten to now,
Dan, let me ask you something. For you and for Jorge, are your organizations doing anything to help particularly Republican candidates in districts where they may be vulnerable because they're supporting this issue?
So we've been very aggressive about meeting with congressmen in their districts, talking to conservative organizations, Tea Party groups. We'll go into wherever we're invited to drive the issues of immigration. This is an important conversation. And it's important for us who are pro-immigration reform to stand in front of groups of who are traditionally in the opposition to speak on the merits of immigration reform, on the economic merits, on the human element of immigration reform, and what it does to strengthen our country. We must do that, and we accept those invitations. And so, yes,
we're doing the same thing. We're meeting with groups all the time, with members, with groups that are on the opposition, you know, and we're speaking to them, and we're having them understand our, you know, our points, you know, why we feel it makes sense, like you're saying, you know, the business, you know, mostly, you know, those folks, you need to speak to business, and you need to speak to the humanitarian issues of the positive issues, the positive side of immigration reform, and we do that. You know, we obviously have been working closely also with the U.S. Chamber of Commerce on, you know, they're big advocates for immigration reform, so we've been working with them too.
And when we look at that, Congressman Mario Diaz-Balart, we looked that you have the support of Bibles, badges, and business on this particular effort. I also look at your Twitter account from time to time, and God, you get creamed from both, you know, from both ends. And sometimes they join me in on that with you from time to time, yeah. And we get, you know, that's tossed right. around a little bit. It is a very difficult business. How close is the House of Representatives to having the support necessary to bring this to the floor for debate?
Helen, thanks for what you do, and you're right. I've seen the Twitters too that whenever you interview me, you get killed from the right and the left.
You must be doing something right.
Yeah, that's right, exactly. And Ileana and I are used to that, and it's unfortunate that you have to get hit because of me or Ileana. But a couple things, and I'll answer your questions of how close you are. Look, first, I do want to say this. Everybody's been very generous with thanking me. I will tell you that this woman next to me has forgotten more about immigration reform than I will ever learn. And when I got to Congress, this woman and Lincoln Diaz-Balart, who, by the way, are the ones who did NACARA, the last legalization, 500,000 families who are here, they're working, they're providing, they're prospering for our country. It's because of her and my brother Lincoln. And to no surprise of anybody else, everything that I do is we do it together. So this is a joint effort from a group of us, including obviously a woman who is probably the most respected person in the House of Representatives. You asked me how close are we. You know, when there was this big euphoria, rightfully so, because the Senate passed the bill, and people were saying it was done. And I got a lot of criticism, and you got a lot of criticism, because I went to your show and others, and I said, I thought we had a 5% chance of passing it in the House. And people said, you're crazy, it's done. And I said, it's not done. We've been doing this for a long time. The highest I went then, a few months later, was maybe 35% chance. 2 months ago, I was asked, and I thought, well, you know, remember when people said it was dead. 15 times people have said it was dead. And yet, Ileana, myself, Luis Gutierrez, have said it's not dead. And the reason we've said it's not dead is because we're working it. We've been working it quietly. There's a lot of groups out there, and I want to mention the folks that are here. There's a lot of groups out there who do a lot of good. By the way, the folks that you have here in this panel, I don't think anybody, there's no groups out there that have done more so much so effectively than these folks here. There are also some groups out there who claim to be pro-immigrant, who do everything and anything they can do to try to kill immigration reform.
In what way?
Well, because they're so political, and sometimes because they want it as a fundraising issue, so they use this issue to raise money and they don't want it solved.
Poison the well.
Yeah, poison the well. But again, that's why I was so thrilled about the folks that you have up here today. I would say that now, I said maybe a few weeks ago to the press that I thought we were up to 45%. I'll tell you something today. Today, I think it's 50-50. 50-50. Today, I think we're on the cusp of getting there. Now.
Congressman, what's driving that push upward?
Time, effort, hard work, dedication, sweat, being able to withstand the negatives from all sides. Look, here's the reality, and that's why Ileana and I are, and we say publicly we get killed. You know, we're friends of Luis Gutierrez, and frankly, we disagree with him in 99% of the issues. But I think I can speak for her. I'll speak for myself. I admire Luis Gutierrez's resolve, his dedication, his willingness to work on immigration reform. And the reality is that when I began this effort with Ileana and Lincoln and a bunch of us in this gang of whatever we were called, gang of 20 then, it was nobody knew about us then. Remember, it was a time when the Democrats controlled the House. Nancy Pelosi was Speaker. President Obama had just gotten elected, making immigration reform one of his key issues. He was going to get it done in the first year. And the Democrats had 60 votes, i.e., an absolute, they could do anything. They didn't need any Republicans. At that time, how do I say this in any other words? The Speaker of the House, Nancy Pelosi, the Democrats, and the President killed immigration reform. They killed it. They didn't want it done. That was the reality. Fast forward then a few years, and then you had a change in the House, and the Republican leadership in the House, and frankly, I think the majority of the Republicans didn't want to get it done either. So we've had then bipartisan opposition from the leaderships, not from members, from the leaderships in particular, against getting it done, regardless of what has been said publicly. Now I think what, through the efforts of all of the folks here, Helen, you included, and Ileana and I and Luis and other members have been very quietly working on drafting every potential option to see if we could get bipartisan support. We think we've got it now done. We think we have it drafted in a way that the reason we think we have it done in a way that's going to get the support is because we're getting the support. We're getting bipartisan support. Yeah. And so I just think it's an issue of, you know, I think it's taken us a long time to get it right. It's very easy to come up with legislation that can get the majority of Democrats in the House, but not enough Republicans to move forward. It's very easy to draft legislation to get the majority of Republicans on board, but not enough Democrats to pass, and to clearly not pass the House, much less become law. What has been elusive to all of us for many, many years is that formula that gets enough Republicans to move forward, because we do have this hazard rule, whether we like it or not. I don't like it, but we have it. And then we have to, you know, have a group of Democrats. That's been elusive. I think we finally have cracked that, and it's just hard work, willing to take the arrows and the barbs and the criticism. Now, I also want to mention one person who's here in the audience. When you talk about immigration reform and we're doing this and we're doing that, you know, we do a lot of negotiations, a lot of talking, a lot of working. But there have been, frankly, there's been one person who has had to draft every different option, every different idea. He's here. He's my chief of staff. Can you stand up? Cesar Gonzalez.
Yeah.
I think, and I know I can speak for Ileana, because again, we're doing this together. This is not one person. This is a group of us. We think we're going to get it done this year. If we get it done, I think we're going to get it done. I think one of the biggest factors is going to be because I have a chief of staff, a friend, a brilliant lawyer, a person who has the trust of Republicans and Democrats, members and staff, who has drafted every potential option, every alternative, every possible view, until finally we have something that is getting the support that we need. So if we get this done, I think we do, the potentially the biggest unsung hero is going to be Cesar Gonzalez.
Congresswoman Ileana Ros-Lehtinen, I believe it was 6 to 8 weeks ago, President Obama called you to speak about this issue. What did he say?
Well, thank you. And Caesar, that's what you get instead of a raise this year. So enjoy it. That's what he told me beforehand. But, you know, I told the president that the best thing that he can do is get out of the way, to not make it immigration a partisan issue. And that's what's been so great about having a leader like Mario Diaz-Balart doing that trumpet sound so that we can all follow, is because he doesn't make it into a partisan issue. He works with all the Democrats, but he's crafting a bill that's based on sound conservative principles. The idea that no one is going to get in front of anybody else who's been waiting in line. And that's really one of those American values. Hey, you shouldn't have special privileges if you came here and you broke some laws. And Mario's bill is so fair to everybody who's been waiting in line, everybody who's been doing the right thing. And I think that's why we're going to get a lot of conservative support, because everyone who comes up to Mario and says, yeah, but you shouldn't reward people for this and that, and he goes, okay, how would you like to see it done? And he listens to the members, and he crafts the bill. And I told the president that one of the biggest obstacles, or excuse, perhaps, that the Republicans are giving for not doing the right thing, for not passing immigration reform, for not legalizing, for not having the path to citizenship, all the things that we would like, for not helping the Dreamers, is that we have this imperial presidency that's looming ever large, that the president is not abiding by the laws, and that he is making his own laws through executive order. Now, maybe we like what he's doing in the end, but we don't like the process by which he's doing it, and at least he should try to work with Congress and give us the time and the space to do it. And so I asked him to slow down what he would like to do, and let Mario and all of our leaders, working hand in hand with our conference, fashion a bill that can withstand all of those naysayers. And you know, when you hear a lot of the criticism about the bill that they have not seen, it's really not founded in reality, because if you were to see it and read it and talk to Mario about what he is doing with the members, you find out that it's really based on fairness, on equality, on opportunity, and nobody's jumping in front of anybody else in line. So I think the president, not because of my suggestion, I think that once he made a lot of calls, people were telling him, slow down with these executive orders, give Congress the opportunity to work this out. Yes, we want things to be fixed. And we know he has said it. It's not a secret. He will take action if Congress does not. But I don't know that that's the right way to threaten or to work with Congress, but everybody's got their own style. But you know, Helen, you pointed out Eduardo Padron here in the audience, and when I'm asked about why I'm for fixing a broken immigration system and what can immigrants offer the United States, we have all of this great talent already, I think of somebody like Eduardo Padron, born in Cuba, came here as a child, PhD, running the biggest college, and what a success story. And when I think what is right with immigration, I look at Eduardo Padron.
Absolutely.
And I look
and
at Congresswoman, at folks like Rudy Fernandez. He's another unsung hero, son of Cuban immigrants, and he is so passionate about immigration reform. So you don't have to be born outside, or you can be born here and know the worthiness of fixing this broken system. Thank you, Rudy, for everything you're doing.
You. Congresswoman, if I may, do we have any Dreamers in the audience? Stand
Yay,
up.
Yay, thank
stand up.
You.
Well, you're already standing up. We have Dreamers who are here.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. God bless you. One, two, three,
there's,
four, five.
There's something that happened in the state legislature of Florida, which,
Amen.
You know, in some ways it didn't get the extraordinary recognition that I think it should. In-state tuition for residents,
but
regardless
it shows
of
how much we have moved
citizenship,
because before that was an issue that people thought, hey, I can campaign on the fact that I stopped in-state tuition for Dreamers. That was actually a talking point. Now it's quite the reverse. And there was such a movement and a grassroots movement. And that's why, even though we're writing the laws, we're a reflection of all of you. And that movement comes from you the people, we the people. That's where the power is in this great country. As you pointed out, it's we the people. You're moving us to do the right thing. So we thank you, the movers and shakers, the people who made that happen. And the people are what made in-state tuition happen.
And of course, there are people like Joe Green,
a genius,
who's been the first one Joe's the first one who's been here who's been clapping for everything that you've been saying. And he's the only one who's not called Jorge or Mario or Dan. It's Joe Green.
I'll take that.
Joe, this is a very personal topic for many of us, but it's really fascinating for me to see people from your world, your field, as you know, the technology industry, who have really stepped forward in an extraordinary way. We know that immigration reform has an economic impact, but in your area in particular, why is this important to you? Why is it important to your industry?
Well, thank you for having us, and I have to say we've done immigration events across the country, and this is one of the most extraordinary groups of people, seeing all of these conservative leaders up here pushing immigration reform. I was actually, as Dan was talking, so we and a number of other folks have declared June Immigrant Heritage Month, and really, you know, we think we need a moment to celebrate that what has built this country is immigration. And so as part of that, I was doing some research on my own family history, and I found this amazing document. So my great-great-grandfather, Joseph Goldman, who I'm named after, immigrated from Russia in 1891. And he entered with four children through Massachusetts somehow, had two kids, including my great-grandfather, in Tennessee, and then ended up in New Orleans, Louisiana. And it is the State of Louisiana Naturalization Certificate that I found. And one of the things I thought was fascinating about it is in that document, he signs, he says, I swear off all allegiance to the Tsar of Russia. Really says, Tsar of Russia, to whom I am a subject. And what that made me think about was, you know, that was a time when most people in the world, they were not citizens of a nation of laws. They were the subject of a single individual. Literally says, potentate or sovereign. And, you know, they were fleeing the pogroms and the Cossacks to come here, which was one of the only nations that was a democracy and a nation of laws. And he came and had his seven children and built a family. And, you know, when I think about, you know, people ask me, why does the tech community, we've gathered many of the leaders in tech, from Mark Zuckerberg to Bill Gates to Reid Hoffman of LinkedIn, down to our new emerging leaders like Drew Houston of Dropbox and Marissa Mayer of Yahoo. About 55 of us have gotten together, put together a lot of resources, and really tried to build an organization for .us, which is really about trying to support members of Congress like Ileana and Mario, who I'm allowed to call by their first names. You know, we were talking about Republican primaries before. There's a congresswoman named Renee Elmers in North Carolina, very conservative district. She's been a real champion in immigration reform. She had a primary challenger who was very anti-immigrant candidate. She went on Laura Ingraham's talk radio show. Laura Ingraham was criticizing her. This was on a Thursday. By Monday, we had $150,000 in TV ads up in her district. And, you know, and she ended up winning 2-1, not because of us, because she's a very strong member of Congress, but really showing, like, this is not the risk it's been perceived for Republicans from the right.
I think that's been such a big change that people have seen that their support, because for a while, there wasn't that perceived support.
Yeah. And so, you know, folks have asked me, like, why do a bunch of tech billionaires care about undocumented immigrants? And, you know, when we started this group, everyone assumed, oh, they're just out there for H-1B visas. But it actually came out of a lot of our personal experiences, many of us living in California, knowing that, literally, you know, I always like to tell people, when you sit down in a restaurant, the food you're eating was grown by, shipped by, prepared by, and your plate will be cleaned by likely undocumented immigrants. And that contribution is so important. And, you know, I've gotten the chance to travel around the world and meet with tech entrepreneurs all over the world. And what's always amazing to me is they all want to come here. And I think that's this asset that we forget about. Many of you guys know Governor Haley Barbour, who's former governor of Mississippi. We're lucky to have him on the board of directors of our conservative affiliate. And he likes to talk about the Gates test. I remember the first time, none of you guys have ever heard him give this spiel, but he said, you know, the best thing about America, the ultimate test of a nation, apologize for my bad Southern accent, is the Gates test. And I was like, what's the Gates test? He said, if all the gates in the world came down, which way would everybody run? And that's not to say we should take all the gates down, but that the drawing power of America is you have little kids all over the world growing up hoping they can come here. And when I ask entrepreneurs, why do you want to come here? They say, because America is a culture where it's okay to try and it's okay to fail. And you hear people in France and Korea and all over the world, they do not have a culture where you can try and fail and try again. And that has always been our culture. And so when we, as a group of entrepreneurs, we think that the thing that makes us a nation of entrepreneurs is that we are a nation of people like my great-great-grandfather who were willing to leave everything behind. I mean, when he left, he was never going back to Russia. He was never going to see anyone he knew ever again. He got on a sailing ship. Must have taken months to get here. I mean, the amount of courage that that took. I mean, starting a company is nothing next to that. And so I think that we believe that immigrants, and that's not just software engineers, that's people picking fruit and cleaning our houses, embody what makes America great.
So in a way, it's a patriotic issue.
Absolutely. This is who we are.
What do you say to people who say, well, that's easy for you to say because you're a billionaire. I'm making this assumption. That you've done well, and then you can live insulated from the reality because you don't have to deal with it in your own way.
Well, I mean, this is saying you cannot be insulated, especially living in places like Florida, places like California. There's 2.5 million undocumented immigrants in California. You know, I first got personally exposed to this issue, just to tell a personal story and then turn it back over. So in high school, I went to a large public high school. It's about half Latino, and in Santa Monica, California. And I played water polo, which you probably wouldn't imagine looking at me now, but at one point I was an athlete. And one day, one of the guys on our team, who's Mexican-American, we're ending practice, and the phone rings, and the coach answers the phone and calls him over, and he answers the phone, and he's talking for a bit, and it was his sister, and his face just goes dead. And his sister had gotten home and couldn't find their parents, and went around the neighborhood trying to, where the heck are my parents? And one of the neighbors was like, oh, I saw ICE. And the kids were both born here, but the parents were undocumented and ended up both getting deported. And they were both hardworking, multiple jobs. And I remember at that moment thinking back, because I think of myself as a student of history, thinking back, you know, my ancestors left Russia because their kids disappeared in the middle of the night and were drafted into the army. And this country, people are not supposed to disappear in the middle of the night. Hardworking, law-abiding people are not supposed to disappear in the middle of the night. And that was just this moment for me, and I've really been passionate about this issue ever since.
And I think immigration laws should be respected, but everybody understands that our immigration system's broken, and that this is an opportunity to take control of our country and take control in ways where we encourage proper immigration, where we have border security, where we have temporary work permits for 10, 13, 12 years. Congressman, how many years would the temporary work permits be? He doesn't give away too much. But it's also providing a legalization process, one way or another, for those who are undocumented. Because sometimes the focus is so much on what to do with those who are undocumented. Not that it should be ignored, but there are other components to this which also enhances the economy of the country.
But I think Joe's point is key, and what you just said. This is not a conversation in a vacuum. Look, if we had an immigration system that worked, it would be a different discussion. If we had a legal system that worked and was fair to folks trying to do things legally, then we'd have a different discussion. If we had borders that were secure, that we know who was coming in and who was leaving, it'd be a different discussion. But when I hear a lot of the opposition, a lot of that opposition is grounded almost as if we had the perfect immigration system and we were trying to mess it up. When the fact is, you almost can't get any worse than what we have today. I mean, really, you almost can't. You would have to try really hard. So we have we do not control who comes in and who leaves our country. How do I know that? Because there are millions of people here who are undocumented. That's the proof. We have a system that's unfair, patently unfair, to people who are trying to legally come to the United States to work, to move here. It is unfair to those who are trying to do things legally because it doesn't work. It does not work. It is a system that is a threat to our national security. We don't even track, the estimates are that anywhere between 35 to 42% of the people who are here undocumented came here legally with a visa in hand. And do you all realize that in the United States of America, we don't track when people leave? I mean, we kind of know that they leave, but we don't do anything with it. And that's crazy. Do you realize that along the border of our country, you have miles, hundreds of miles, of public lands owned by you, the taxpayer? And do you realize that our law enforcement officers are not allowed to go in public lands owned by the federal government on motorized vehicles? So where do you think the coyotes with their Humvees and their 4x4s go? I mean, I hate to tell you, this just sounds like a bad Saturday Night Live skit. It is so broken. It is so unfair to folks doing things legally. It is so dangerous to our national security interests. And it is hurting our economy to such a degree that I think it is fair, absolutely legitimate, and it's a positive thing, to discuss the specifics as to how do we fix what's broken. But I will tell you where I do have a bit of a problem, and when most of the opposition isn't, well, look, that specific, we should change, that specific, here are some ideas. By the way, most conservatives do have that attitude. Let's do this, let's do that, let's figure out how we can do that, as Ileana said, in a way that's fair. But some of the opposition is basically, we don't want to do anything. Well, if you don't want to do anything, you are then advocating for a broken, for a porous border system. You're advocating for having millions of people here in de facto amnesty. You are advocating for a system that is hurting our economy, hurting our ability to create jobs. And Ileana and I and Luis Gutierrez and others and Alguacides and so many others, and we have differences with our colleagues, but we did not get elected to sit back while we know that there's a system that is not working for our country.
Joe Green, what time do you have?
We're 10 minutes.
10 minutes, okay, we have. Joe, what do people need to know about forward.us? What about forward.us or US?
We say both.
We say both, good, so I'm clear. What do people need to know about forward.us, and what do people need to know about immigration reform to be a part, to contribute, and or to appropriately question what's going on?
Well, I think that, look, we've tried to construct an organization that tries to take a very pragmatic approach. We've done something kind of unique, which is we're set up to try to create political support and political space. We understand that there's a lot of members of Congress that want this to happen. It can be sometimes politically difficult in their districts, usually not as difficult as some people think it is. And so we operate on both sides of the aisle. We are completely agnostic to party. If you're pro-immigration reform, we're pro-you. And so that's allowed us, I think, to really work effectively with both sides. And we do a whole set of work from events like this to polling, TV ads, work online. We had an amazing event last year. We had a Dreamer Hackathon. A hackathon is a Silicon Valley thing we do where everyone stays all night and hacks together new products. And we had dreamers who code come together with people like Mark Zuckerberg and Reid Hoffman and Drew Houston to code up. And we actually created this awesome thing called Push for Reform, where you can see where every member of Congress stands. These guys both stand very well. And you can send them letters, you can send them emails, you can call them. So, you know, as they were saying, they need to hear from their constituents. And the more, and over, I think, over the next 2 months, as Mario said, we have this real window to maybe get something done. And the most important thing is that people are hearing constantly from their constituents all over the country, and we've tried to provide tools to do that. We're going to keep pushing, and you know, we're going to do everything that we can to make sure that, you know, members of Congress who, you know, stick their neck out on this feel that they have, you know, full levels of support on both sides of the aisle. And I think that I think that we're really getting close, you know, due to the work of these great members of Congress and others.
So, and Joe and Helen, I think that what we've seen in the primary contest up to now is that I don't know of a single candidate who has lost his or her election because of support for changing a system that is totally broken down. Not a single one.
Well, I think, Congresswoman, there's also recognition of missed revenue opportunities that you get that we could have fixed if we had immigration reform, taking control of borders, dealing with temporary work permits, looking at this in ways and models, and with people like Joe Green helping immigration reform being part of the solution for the new economy of the 21st century.
Well, and one thing I just want to say is I've gotten, one of the things that's been awesome about working on Forward is I've gotten to spend a lot of time here in Miami, which is always great, and really gotten to know the burgeoning Miami tech community. And what's, you know, I grew up in LA. I really didn't spend any time in Miami until relatively recently. And as you guys, you know, I like the joke, you know, people always tell, you know, what's the best thing about Miami? It's close to the United States, right? You don't need it. And it's obviously this is the United States, but she said it, not me. No. But what's amazing, right, is this is a city that's run by immigrants, and this is a city that is truly international in character. And I think that, you know, it is the gateway to Latin America. It's, you know, people call it the Hong Kong of Latin America. People from all over Latin America look up to Miami. And I think, you know, the role of the Miami tech community as this, you know, we just had the Emerge conference here, the ability for, you know, Miami, more than almost anywhere I've been, the ability for the tech community here to grow is about immigration. There's all these entrepreneurs all over Latin America that want to base their businesses here in Miami, want to move between Miami and Latin America, and so many of them are held up by not being able to get visas. I mean, people trying to bring engineers in from across the country. One of our supporters, Juan Calle, just sold his company, .co. It's the Colombian government domain, which is run out of Miami, right? How crazy is that? You know, he sold his company for like $100 million, really successful entrepreneur, and they're, all these guys are constantly held back, and if they could have entrepreneur visas, if they could have more visas, you know, kids graduating from Miami-Dade College, who we then kick out of the country, it's crazy. And like, our economy has always been built in this way, and that's true, you know, more true here in Miami than anywhere else I've been.
And Dan, when you look at entrepreneurship, and I know that this has been a big focus of LIBRE initiative as well, Hispanics are very entrepreneurial, and a lot of these entrepreneurs are women.
No, without a doubt, Latina women are opening up new businesses at three times the national rate, mostly because they've been on the outside and are now wanting to get in on the inside and access the market. And we want to help in that, obviously, and we're trying to rein in a little bit of government control and rein in the politicians who want to advance their aspirations instead of allowing individuals to advance their own aspirations. And so, what, you know, what we want to see, again, is a country that provides an atmosphere for new immigrants coming in to prosper, to risk capital like my father did. You know, he worked for 20 years in the fields, took everything he owned and risked it on a small business. And that we were on our way up after that. You know, we accessed the middle class. I was able to go off to college. And now, you know, my children have all the opportunities opened up to them because of the trailblazing that my parents did. And I talked about my aunts and uncles that came to Mexico as well. They did fantastic as well. They prospered very well. And now their children are professionals, doctors and lawyers and things. And so, you know, I see the next generation as having absolutely no excuse to prosper in America. And that's what I see for immigrants to come in. It is a process. The economic ladder takes a while to climb up, but that's okay. We're willing to work hard. Hispanics come here to work hard. And you've seen that from one generation to the next, the sacrifices that our parents did, I tip my hat to them. I want to honor that, and I want to work hard like they worked hard. And I see that in my children, and I see that in the immigrant. The immigrant class does not come for welfare, does not come for dependency. You know, obviously there's a small percentage that come to abuse certain systems or whatever. But the vast, vast, significant majority are here to work hard and to become entrepreneurial, and we want to set the table for that.
And I think as a final thought, Jorge Plasencia, when you look at the example that Dan Garza explains through the LIBRE initiative, Hispanics actually do assimilate. It's not them or us, it's everybody.
Sure, I mean, we as a marketer, I can tell you that we definitely assimilate. We're very proud of our Latino heritage. Know what country we're from. If you ask us, we'll say we're Cuban American, Mexican American. I mean, we speak to our country of origin, but we're very, very much a part of this country. We want our children to be a part of this country. We want our children to live that American dream, and we're very grateful to this country, like you were saying. My mom is sitting right here, and my mom can tell you. Thank you. She came over in 1961. You know, with a few dollars in their pocket, they came over after losing a pretty extraordinary business in Havana, starting from scratch, had to work a number of jobs to provide for her siblings, for her parents. And my mom's story is the American story. You know, just like my mom, there's millions and millions of moms across the country that what they want for their children is a better future. And that's what my mom instilled in us, faith, family, love of this country. And I think that's what we want. That's what we want for this country. And I think that that 86% that I was speaking to earlier about those polls, that 86%, that's what they want. They want a better future for the children of this country. They want a better future for America, and they want to be able to prosper in this country without having, like Janet and I say, I'll be chair of NCLR for another year, right? We feel that once we get this immigration cloud over us, we're going to really be able to delve into the true issues, you know, education and so many other issues that are truly so important. But as long as we have this issue over our community, you know, we're kind of stuck. We got to move it forward. We got to move it forward. And what a great way to end with, you know, thanking my friend who's become my friend in this process, Joe Green. I commend you for what you're doing. What Ileana and Mario said, I couldn't say it enough. I mean, I've seen firsthand how this guy and his organization are just committed, like you cannot imagine, to getting this done.
And let me just ask, Joe, what are you afraid of would happen if immigration reform doesn't go through?
I mean, I think, you know, we have so many millions of people whose families are being torn apart. You know, we have so many, I mean, so many, like, economic opportunities that we forego. I mean, you have, there was last year, so if you drive on the freeway from San Francisco south on the 101, all of the billboards are tech recruiting billboards. Work at this company, work at this company, work at this company. And there was a billboard that popped up last year from the government of Canada, a big Canadian maple leaf on, that said it. Having H-1B visa problems? Come to Canada. Visas for startups.
Brilliant on their part.
Brilliant. And we had, and I called the 1-800 number, and one rings, somebody picks up and says, hello, Canadian immigration, how can we recruit your company? That's the attitude that we should have. And, you know, this is such an opportunity for us. And I mean, all of these tech companies have offices in Vancouver. They call them the holding tanks, because they try to get visas for people to come to the U.S. They can't do it, so they have to get them a Canadian visa. And they sit there, and they work on Pacific time zone in Canada, not consuming in America, not using, you know, not going to U.S. restaurants and U.S. hotels. It's just all of this foregone opportunity for our economy. It's bananas. And I think we have a real opportunity this year, and what's great about all these different forces coming together, and we get to work with everybody from labor unions to the Chamber of Commerce and the whole spectrum, is that I think we really have a chance to kind of really fix this. You know, both, you know, the way you fix illegal immigration is you make legal immigration work, right? You know, I remember my old co-founder, Sean Parker, founded Napster. When Napster first came out, you could only illegally download music. There was no legal way to download it. Once iTunes and Spotify and the legal ways came around, people, you know, much less feel the need to illegal. And so if people can come legally, it's easier to enforce the border. We're not rounding up people who want to come and pick tomatoes. We're rounding up the real bad guys. And so I think we have the opportunity with Republicans and Democrats coming together to actually fix this system. And so I just hope, you know, over the next couple months that we can continue up the support and the pressure and, you know, do everything we can to support these members of Congress that are doing the hero's work to try to get this thing done.
We are a motley crew, and we are in favor of immigration reform. Ladies and gentlemen, help thank this panel for a wonderful conversation. By next week. Thank you.
Thank you, Helen. Thank you.
Thank you.